morning's gospel lesson is from Matthew chapter 21. And when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on an ass, and on a colt and foal of an ass.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the ass and the colt and put their garments on them, and he sat thereon. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sherry. And thank you all for putting up with my improv children's sermon there. Would you join me in a moment of prayer today? Most gracious God, as we enter this holy week, open our hearts and our minds that we may truly hear, receive, and experience your word for us this day. Amen. All right. So today we are concluding our sermon series based on Adam Hamilton's book, Making Sense of the Bible. And we're going to look at some of those challenging passages of Scripture that are found in the New Testament. Now, the author of our series addresses several areas, and I'm going to be exploring three of those. And these are classic questions that are asked concerning Scripture. First, can the gospel accounts of Jesus be considered reliable? Second, how do we address the question of women as church leaders? And third, how does the Bible view those who identify themselves as homosexual? Now, again, as a caveat, I will be treading lightly on these areas, recognizing the adult nature and the fact that we do have a very mixed audience here today. And so there's some terms I just won't use, and so you'll catch on. Just stay with me. So while our focus is on the New Testament today, there are some passages that are referenced in the Old Testament, so we are going to flip back and look at those as well. So first, can the gospel accounts of Jesus be considered reliable? Now, we have talked about the Gospels. It's those first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And the first three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are known as the Synoptics because they are extremely similar, offering very similar accounts of the same events in identical manners. Now, there's a reference that I have used since seminary. It's called the Gospel Parallels. And it puts the entire books of Matthew, Mark, and Luke side by side by side. So you can see the similarities and the differences between the synoptics. And so I'd like us to take a look at the other two accounts of Jesus' triumphant entrance into Jerusalem. And so the first one, as I mess with this mic here, is in the book of Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. So if you use your Pew Bibles, or if you brought your Bible with you, it's the second book of the New Testament, second book in Matthew, Mark. And we're looking at chapter 11, beginning with the first verse. And we'll read through this one, and then I'll just point out some things when we get to the Luke account. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you'll find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here immediately.' They went away and found the colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches as they had cut from the fields. Then those who went on ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom, is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest." It's very, very, very similar to what was read for us from the book of Matthew. But I'd like us to take a look at Luke's account. This is interesting. If you look at Luke, the next gospel in, the next book in, Luke 19, beginning with verse 28. And I'm not going to read the whole account, but I'm just going to point out a couple of things. Let's flip down to verse 35. So Luke 19, beginning with verse 35. Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began praising God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power. And it goes on, but there's some interesting pieces that are missing here. First of all, where's the palms? There's no mention of palms in Luke's account. Where's the, and when you look at who is actually praising Jesus as he's coming into town, it's not the crowds, it's the disciples in Luke's account. And finally, where's that word Hosanna? It's not there. And yet this is all the things that we have built around what we now call Palm Sunday. And so you see some differences in these accounts, even for something as significant as Jesus coming into Jerusalem. So I have to ask the question, when we find this kind of disparity throughout the Gospels, how can they be trusted as reliable? Well, I'd like you to recall that the Gospels were written sometime between 65 and 90 AD, somewhere between 35 and 60 years after the time of Jesus. How's our memory? How's our memory? Who here has been with your significant other at least 35 years or more? 35 years or more. Okay, there's several of you that have. Okay.
Steve Walker.
And there it is. Mark and I will celebrate our 35th anniversary this year in September, but we dated for 5 years before we got married. So I've known him for almost 40 years. And as he would say, 40 long years. There are stories, though, that are told within our family. There we are. That's the big old family picture there, the wedding party. There are stories that are told within our family over that time period that are, talk about it, profound events in our history. And but our family members have a tendency to remember them differently, or maybe they spin the story differently. Not sure how that works. Mark remembers the panic of the when the minister refused to start our wedding without our marriage license in hand. We had it. It was just back at the apartment where Mark was staying. We didn't have it in hand, and he refused to start the service without that. Mark remembers the panic, and he'll tell you all about that. He remembers some very interesting details that I don't remember at all. And I remember things from that day that maybe he doesn't. My father was very ill, but he insisted on walking me down the aisle, and so I remember how he had to literally set his determination and his resolve along with setting his legs in order to walk me down the aisle. Now, most people just remember crying with tears of joy. I keep saying, nobody was looking at me, they were looking at my dad, because they understood the struggle that he had gone through for 7 years. And so I just remember him having to stand there and set his resolve to make this happen. Have you seen that kind of determination in folks that are really determined? This was my dad. 35 years is a long time. The fact that the Gospels agree as much as they do bears credence to their reliability. Each of these authors was reflecting on the profound effect Jesus had and considered their potential readers to present compelling accounts of the Son of God. each believed that Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah, and they proceeded to present accounts that would lead readers to the same conclusion. Now, I have not talked about the Gospel of John, and we did note earlier in this series that that particular gospel is a more spiritual gospel. Therefore, getting actual events in precise detail was not the focus of this particular author. John gives us a glimpse of the nature of Jesus while including accounts of miracles and encounters not included in the other gospels. And yet, all four gospels speak of miracles, teachings, radical hospitality, and Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. With all that said, I do believe that we can consider the gospel accounts of Jesus to be reliable and profound for us to study and to incorporate into our lives today. If you ever wanted a little fun challenge, I call it fun, but you know, I'm a pastor. Look at the names of the disciples in the Gospel of John versus the Gospel of Luke. It's interesting, they're very different. So, the next question that we're considering as part of today is that rather bold and sometimes controversial statement, women need not apply. Women need not apply. There are three passages of Scripture that are always used to prevent women from holding leadership positions, particularly in the church. And all of these come from Paul's letters. All of them come from Paul's letters. So we're going to take a look at the first one. It is in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and it begins in verse 33. Now, Corinthians, the Gospels are the first four books of the New Testament. You've got Acts, Romans, Corinthians. So it's the seventh book in. So 1 Corinthians, there's two books of Corinthians. So the first one, we talked about how these are laid out and how these particular letters are put in order of length. And so this one is the second longest or close to. So I'll start reading in the 33rd verse, I think. 1 Corinthians. The, 14th chapter. 1 Corinthians 14, beginning with verse 33. So I think that's where I'm starting. Yeah. For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all the congregations of the Lord's people. Women should remain silent in churches. They are not allowed to speak, but must be in submission, as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home, for it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. How many times have you all read that and just sort of glossed over it? What do you do with that when it's right there? Let's see, where am I? It's kind of a quandary, isn't it? How is it then that the United Methodist Church has appointed pastors here for some time, women pastors here for some time? You have quite a history of female pastors in this church. How do we do that? How's that possible when you read something like this? And how do we reconcile these instructions by Paul with his own practice of placing women in leadership roles in the church that he is, in the many churches that he established? He placed women often in leadership roles. How do we reconcile that? We take a look at another letter that Paul wrote to the churches in Galatia, and we look at his famous statement, Galatians 3:28. Paul makes this particular statement of an egalitarian nature of the gospel. There is no longer There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. We're faced with a little bit of a quandary here. So if you spend any time reading Scripture, you'll become acutely aware of the patriarchal nature of these readings. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 13 and 14, after Paul states that it is shameful for women to speak in church, he notes this reason. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. So, let's go back to the creation stories in Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. In Genesis 1, you'll see that the account of creation is egalitarian. Men and women were created at the same time, and neither was given dominance. They were partners in subduing the earth. Take a look at Genesis 1, verse 27. It's the very first book of the Bible, very first chapter, verse 27. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. In Genesis 2, however, Adam is formed, and then Eve. Genesis 2:18 puts it this way. Let's see if I can find it here. The Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." And it is that word helper that has been misunderstood. The Hebrew word is ezer, E-Z-E-R, which indicates a stronger individual coming to the aid of someone who is weaker. It's used to describe God 21 times in the Old Testament, and it is used twice to refer to Eve. But everything changes in chapter 3. In Genesis, when sin enters the picture. And from this point on, a patriarchal way of life was initiated. So as we see this story as archetypal, we talked about this also, the word typical and the word prototype come together for this word archetypal. We put ourselves into this story. Part of the consequences of sin is the induction of a patriarchal society. And we don't have to look very far to see that playing out in our own lives today. How many times have we seen women abused at the hands of their spouses or boyfriends? Men are killed by their spouses or girlfriends about 7% of the time. For women, it's about 40% of the time. So, with that in mind, consider the fact that Jesus entered the world in order to reverse the curse of sin and death. Jesus came to restore the beauty of communion with God. Jesus came to correct the wrong that was initiated by all those times that we have submitted to the ugliness of sin. Jesus came to reverse the curse of Eden. And part of that curse is the subordination of women. Jesus came to return to God's will of a partnership rather than a patriarchy. So, recognizing the lens with which these scriptures were written in Paul's letters and considering our own lens or hermeneutics, this is a quote from the author, is it not time to recognize that Paul's words about women remaining silent do not reflect God's timeless will for the role women are to play in the church? I've heard a couple of other explanations concerning the church in Corinth, where this first account was written. And it's interesting, if you study Corinthians and that church in Corinth, you will realize that that church was messed up. It was one messed up church. They had serious problems. So this scripture was written in the context of how to conduct worship. What was happening is the men would sit on one side, the women on the other, and if the women didn't understand something that was going on or said in the service, they would yell across to their husbands during the service, asking for them to explain it to them, basically. That's basically what was going on. That was one of the explanations that I heard from my mentor pastor. Another one is this. In the original text, when you go back to the original scrolls that were transcribed and copied and rewritten, in those original scrolls, that scripture doesn't exist. It's not there. What was happening was, as folks would, you would have one guy that would transcribe a bit of the scripture. They would pass it to the guy in front of them, and he would keep going. Well, sometimes these guys would put notes in the sides. And apparently one of those notes then was incorporated or potentially incorporated into scripture. So those are a couple other explanations that were noted concerning women in leadership roles. Okay, so finally, I wanted to address the question of how the Bible views homosexuality. So in order to do this, we have to once again return to the Old Testament. Now, Moses laid out the law concerning same-sex sexual activity in Leviticus 18:22 And in Leviticus, that's a typo, I'm sorry, that's Leviticus 20, verse 13. In both these cases, the relations between same partners was considered an abomination. And yet there are two accounts in the Torah of men lying with men as with women, and neither addresses two men or women seeking to share lives together as companions. Neither one of those accounts that Moses was probably speaking out against talks about what we see as a loving relationship between same-sex partners. So the first account is in Genesis 19, and it is the story of Sodom. There is a practice that comes from that word that I will not say, and you can sort of extrapolate from there, but it is about the city of Sodom. If you read this story carefully, you will see two things. First of all, there is clearly patriarchal norms in place. The second is the act that's being described has absolutely nothing to do with a loving relationship, but it actually has everything to do with violence and sexual acts. And again, there's a word that we use for that that I will not say today. These acts were for dominance and power in order to humiliate the men or the women who would be violated. So it is possible that Moses was condemning this act. There's also something else that was going on at the time. There was a pagan ritual that was going on in the cities around where the Hebrews were. It was temple prostitution, and it most likely involved sexual acts during worship ceremonies. In this case, Moses very well may have been speaking out against idolatry and not participating in this pagan worship. The practice was also not what we see today as a loving relationship between same-sex partners. So considering these acts were noted as an abomination, we have to consider other things that were also noted as abominations. And the three that I picked out happen to have something to do with food. I must have been hungry when I wrote this, I'm sorry. But these three things were known as abominations: eating pork, eating rabbit, or eating any seafood that did not have scales. Oh no, there goes our Maryland is for crabs motto. It goes right out the window. So the word here is that we need to use caution when quoting scripture that may work to exclude anyone from experiencing a meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So when we review Acts chapter 15, we noted that much of the law was set aside for the Gentiles rather than placing too heavy of a yoke for them to bear. However, Paul seems to take up the issue of homosexuality in the book of Romans, and we're going to look at that one. Again, it's the fifth book in the four Gospels, Acts, Romans, first chapter. If anyone cares to turn to that one in the New Testament. Romans chapter 1, it's right after Acts. And we're starting with verse 26. Okay. Sorry, I had to make sure I had the right one too. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful acts with other men and received to themselves the due penalty for their error. So, while set in the backdrop of speaking out against pagan worship, these verses seem to point to and condemn idolatry. Yet there was another practice that Paul may have been addressing, and that is the practice of pederasty. In Paul's time, sexuality for boys in particular was seen on a spectrum. Some would fall on the more masculine end of this spectrum, while others fell on the more effeminate end of this spectrum. In Paul's time, mature men were utilizing the practice of taking these effeminate boys as students and lovers, a practice that we would still condemn today. So where does that leave us? Where does that leave us with this big issue here? The Bible does not seem to address a loving, committed relationship between same-sex partners. Jesus never spoke about it either. And we have these confusing scriptures that may, in fact, be addressing something very different than what we see as a loving homosexual relationship. So once again, we just need to use caution in interpreting scripture. And as we're ending this series, I wanted to leave you with some thoughts of the author. So this is Hamilton speaking. As we read and interpret scripture, I'd suggest that there are three broad categories, let's call them buckets, that biblical passages fit into. There are passages of scripture, I would suggest the vast majority, that reflect the timeless will of God for human beings. For instance, the scriptures that say, love your neighbor as yourself. There are other passages that reflect God's will in a particular time, but not for all time. And this would include some of that ritual law that you find in the Old Testament. And then there are passages that reflect the culture and historical circumstances in which they were written, but never reflect God's timeless will, like those related to slavery. There are a lot of scriptures about slavery. And so we can think of those particular ones as maybe reflecting the culture. The question regarding loving and committed relationships between same-sex people is, in which of these three buckets do the handful of verses that speak out about same-sex intimacy belong? Conservatives on this issue believe that they fit in the first bucket. Many moderates or progressives believe they fit in either the second or, most likely, the third bucket. The earliest apostles made a dramatic decision at the Jerusalem Council that some scriptures were no longer binding. I think it is critical that we learn from them. I believe there are times when God calls us to ask questions of our Bible, and as we do, we set aside those things that may not reflect the timeless will of God, even as we recognize and guard against the temptation to set aside something that is simply inconvenient. I think that's a good caution for all of us as well. It's pretty clear. Through this series, I haven't necessarily given you definitive answers on all of these particular topics. But I do continue to encourage you to read and to study Scripture in order to gain a better understanding of God, the biblical authors, and ourselves as we read and wrestle with Scripture. Carvel's Bible study is wide open to anyone who cares to join it. And guess what? They're working on 1 Corinthians right now. So they're working right through this particular controversial book right now. And so that one's always open. But I encourage you to continue to seek out ways to study. If anybody's interested, I would be more than happy to initiate a study, either on the afternoons or evenings, to just continue this particular wrestling. We didn't cover more than half of what's in this book and the topics that are raised. And so, you know, we can dig deeper if you care to. It's also very clear to me that we can worship together in this sanctuary and still hold very different views. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So as we move forward, as this body of Christ known as Mayo United Methodist Church, let's continue to open our hearts. Let's continue to open our minds, our understanding to what God is calling us to do in order to stay in love with God, share that love with others, and make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Now, my guess is that's probably not the Palm Sunday sermon you were expecting.